If you see the economics of this one, so there were six ways of producing the ethyl alcohol. So six possible ways, but in India limited to fermentation by sucrose substrate due to unavailability. So the starch and paper waste we have seen already, they were facing many problems in raw material. So these are not the good ways for the production of ethanol. So we will mainly depend upon the sucrose substrate, that is sugarcane juice or other the materials to produce the ethanol. Then earlier petroleum based ethanol was high in production by sugar cane molasses or juice. Hence the petroleum ethanol serves cheap ethanol, but the petroleum prices are going high nowadays, so it is not a good way for the production of ethanol. So large are coming to produce the ethanol from the organic waste. So the plants or other techniques which are coming, which can produce the ethanol, or we can say the bioethanol in nowadays, and ethanol we can use as a fuel. So the many the research is going on in order to produce the bioethanol from the waste and the other things, and the new the variety of the plants also coming, which we can give the material which we can convert into the bioethanol by the use of the fermentation techniques. And trends in ethanol industry growth in India. So few state only leading in India. So those state which sugar cane in more quantity, they will produce the ethanol. And bioethanol plants are being set up in India. And storage of alcohol badly affects alcohol based industry and the foreign exchange. So this is one of the problem in the alcohol industry. The Reliance and IPCL incorporate chemicals to meet demands, and the new measures are taken by government to produce more ethanol via fermentation use. Then fermentation products from petroleum. So it has been known that bacteria can attack hydrocarbons and undesirable materials in fuels. So in petroleum we know already that mostly they will be organic materials, so that can be attacked by the bacteria, and after attacking they may produce the useful products. So the microorganism, particularly yeast and bacteria, can produce proteins in presence of aqueous nutrient salt solution containing the essential inorganic sulfur and phosphorus and nitrogen compound. So N alkanes are also carbon source for SCP, that is single cell protein. While gaining energy, yeast degrades N paraffins into CO2 producing proteins, rich cellular components. So here bacteria and yeast can double their weight in 3 to 5 hours, whereas plant takes 1 to 2 weeks and animal 3 to 4 months. So the bacteria and yeast, they are very useful in order to get the production. Also, land, labor and water requirement is less in the if you are using the bacterial fermentation techniques. Then the bacterial the fermentation is very useful to produce the protein. So fed is N paraffin fraction, then can degrade only straight chain paraffins. So the branch chain, it is very difficult as they are more stable. So the straight chain can be degraded into the protein fraction. So this is the N paraffin in presence of oxygen and the nutrients, we can have the proteins with the evaluation of the CO2 and the energy. The raw material in this one will be the oxygen from air, then ammonium salt as a nutrient, then salt of potassium sulfur and the phosphorus and the other mineral salts as a nutrients. Then compressed air is bubbled into fermented, not only serves as reactant but also assist in heat removal by evaporation. So here the air which are the giving, it will lead to the fermentation for the aerobic bacteria, also it will agitate and also it will remove the heat by the evaporation. General time is taken as 3 to 6 hours with the temperature 30 to 70 degrees centigrade, and to produce the stream is continuously withdrawn from the fermented and after separation dried to give the product ready for packaging and shipping. So this is the advantage over here, we can readily continuously withdraw the products and we can directly pack them and we can ship them. So this is the process flow diagram for the production of the proteins by the petroleum route. So we add the inoculum, then minerals, water, gas, soil and the air. So inoculum is the yeast over here, or the microorganism which produce the proteins. So here the whatever the gases which are producing, that will be vented out, and the water which is remaining, that can be separated. So that will come to the separator S, then the cooler or condenser, it will lead to the cooling, and the fermenter, it will ferment the reaction mixture. Then it will come for this the separator where harvesting is taking place. Then gas or product, that will be separated. Then water will be separated, and it will come to the dryer where protein is dried one. So it will come here, then intermediate products that will come, so the leaching, then the evaporator and the separator, that will lead to the byproduct recovery. So here is the recovery column that will recover the byproducts, whereas the dried product which is coming over here, that can be dried and we can have the finished protein concentrated. So here the what are the proteins which are produced? We separated gas, soil and the water, then dried product which you can have the finished protein concentrate, and the other product which are forming which can recover in the recovery vessel. So here these are the major difference between fermentation alcohol and the alcohol from etherine. So here the use of corn and molasses, then storage of these the corn and molasses, then grinding, then hydrolysis, then growth of inoculating culture, then fermentation of the corn mesh and the distillation. Whereas in alcohol, it is the liquefaction of the petroleum gases containing ethylene, then rectification, then dehydrogenation, then distillation, and the rectification and purification of the alcohol is needed. Then after the ethanol, the other the diluted one or the concentration different ethanol, we can classify them into beer and then wines and the other liquors. So here beer of alcoholic content which is 2 to 7% made by brewing various cereals with hops usually added to impart a more or less bitter taste and to control the fermentation that follows. So here the beer is mainly the quality of beer will depend upon the how much alcohol content is there, then what is the raw material used for the beer manufacturing, and what is the taste of the beer. So generally the beer will have the taste, and for to impart taste we are adding the other component which will not the part of the fermentation. So here the raw material which are using is the cereals that will include barley, then flax rye, then oats, corn, wheat, corn, which will contain major the starch content. Then to make malt is steeped in cold water and spread out on floor for 5 to 8 days, turning regularly to let it germinate at the proper time when enzyme growth arrested by heat. So here the grains are taken, then they are allowed for germinate, and germination at desired step it will be arrested by heating. Then barley germinated in water produces a sweet syrup term malting, and the barley malting process lasts for 48 hours. The sprouted barley grain which is malt is then roasted longer. Higher roast produces a darker, more flavorful barley, hence a darker, more flavorful beer. So here the roasting will produce the color of the beer, and also the taste will be different. In flavorful barley, flavorful beer if you want, then we have to go for the roasting technique of the barley grains. Then conversely, a lower, shorter roast produces a less flavorful beer. So the more roasting, more flavorful. But also we should have the limitation on the roasting, otherwise it will give very dark color and it may char the cereals which are using for the fermentation. Then after roasting, the barley kernels are ground and mixed with water to form a mash. Then enzymes in the grain convert starches of the mash grains into sugar. The sweet liquid is called the wort. So what happens? First we have let germinate, the germination is arrested, then we have roasted, and after roasting we are adding them, and the enzymes, they are converting starch into the alcohol, and the sweet liquid which is called as the wort. So wort is boiled and hops are added to create a hopped wort. So hop it will give the taste to the beer. Then the liquid is cooled to the right temperature and yeast is added. So here yeast is added and it will further ferment the starch which is produced in the mash. So this is the flow chart for the production of the beer. So generally the barley malt is taken as the raw material. So malt or the rice or corn that is taken, then they are rolled, then hoppers are rolled, then they are cooled. And then mash tun is at 76 degree centigrade, they are roasted. Then a filter is required to filter it, or alternative filter to filter the raw material. Then the hop is added and taken into the brew kettle. Then whirlpool separator will separate the grains and the other waste materials. then they are cooled by the airflow, and they were cooled at 60 degree centigrade from 76. Then they are taken into the fermentation tank, so the temperature is maintained around 4 to 14 degree centigrade, and yeast culture is added over here. Then after centrifugation, the remaining material that will be sending out, and the beer which is forming, that will come out. So the chiller, it will be chilled. Then finishing filter will remove the filters. Then at 0 degree centigrade it will be stored. So at this one, the further fermentation is arrested over here. Then they can be sent into the various grades. So such as the government tanks, then it is it will come in boiling machine. Then it is go for the copying, pasteurizing and labeling for remove the bacteria, and they can be canned. Or they can be came into the packing machine, and they can directly send as the keg beer. So here it is the raw material that will show over here. So what they are doing. So here the germination takes place, then arresting will take place, then the removal of the husk, and the starch will give the sweet liquid which contains some part of the beer. Then it will come to the brew kettle and the separator. Then it is cooled and sent to the fermentation tank. Then it will be fermented. Then waste matter is centrifuged out, and the beer which can send as the keg beer, or which by bottling we can have the canned or bottled beer. Then the Louis Pasteur, as we discussed earlier, it has showed that the fermentation was an anaerobic process carried out by microorganisms, and showed certain organisms produce lactic acid, other produce alcohol. So discovered that heating the solution prevented the souring of wine during aging and extended shelf life of the beer and milk. So earlier there was problem was the souring of the wine before. So souring of wine was taking by the microorganisms by the more fermentation. So what he did, he has taken the beer and then he heated. Then he seen that the beer which is heated and kept has not soured, but the beer which is not heated got soured. So he found that there may be some organisms which may lead to the fermentation. So the he showed that some are giving lactic acid, and some are giving the alcohols. So the Louis Pasteur has developed the technique of heating beer. So generally the technique of heating and killing the bacteria, so that is called as the pasteurization. So pasteurization means flash heating of the liquid to remove the bacteria and prevent the further fermentation. So the beer production, if you see, then first thing is bring of the mash to the cooled hop wort, then fermentation, and then storage, finishing and packaging for market. So the malting, the first thing is takes place in the malt houses, occasionally in brewery, may control germination of barley. So here the moisture, temperature and carbon dioxide is maintained. Then goal is to produce enzyme useful for brewing. So enzymes here used are amylases and proteases. So the malting here is seen. Soaking of the grain, then allow from the control germination, maximum enzyme production, minimum enzyme activity and plant growth. Then kiln drying for the germination stop. Then stabilization malted barley, impart color and flavor by roasting. So here light malt, dark malt, amber malt and black pectin mark depend upon the roasting of the germinated barley. Then brewing is nothing but the enzymatic conversion of starch into the maltose, proteins to amino acid, then extraction of hop flavors and aromatic compounds, and sterilizing maltose, then the hop flavor solution. Then brewing will contribute to milling of malted barley. So careful cracking of malted barley, then shatter endosperm and keep husk in large pieces, then adding water and control temperature for enzymatic action. So here the mash is taking place, where the malted barley being mixed with warm water, and the enzymes convert the starch into maltose, the proteins to amino acid, creating what is known as the sweet wort. Then the lautering or filtering. So the sweet wort is separated from the spent barley by a filtration step known as the lautering. The barley has served as the primary filtering material. Here the remaining spent grains are being removed from the sweet wort with this screen. So here the waste material is filtering out. So that we have seen in the process flow diagram. Then mash tun with the used mash. So here this is the spent malt that acted as filtering bed for the sweet wort. Then scraping out of the used mash, and then sweet or what which has the maltose and the amino acids. Then the kettle which serves for the sweet wort, then bring to boil, add hops, then extract flavor and the aromatic compound and sterilizes hop wort in this kettle. Then the fermentation tank where we add the yeast as a fermentating. So after the yeast is added, added to the hop wort, fermentation to the maltose to ethanol occurs in these tanks. Then adding yeast to the fermentator, then blow off hoses of the fermentation tanks. The fermentation produces both ethanol and the CO2. The CO2 is allowed to vent out through these blow off hoses whose ends are immersed in a tank of water, producing an air lock and preventing oxygen from entering the fermentation tank. So these will go to the water. It will avoid the oxygen to enter in this one, as it is anaerobic fermentation reaction. Then the next one is the wine production. So the wine can be defined as the fermented fruit juice. So most wine is fermented grape juice, but almost any fleshy fruit can be fermented. Then fermenting of sugar in fruits to alcohol occurs naturally, and many animals have enjoyed getting intoxicated on fermented fruit. Thus it is not unlikely that good wine was humanity's first experience with alcohol. So here, if you use the more ripe fruit, the fermented fruit, then you can feel the intoxicated. So that is nothing but the sugars in the fruit that got fermented into the alcohol. Then evidence of fermented grape juice has been seen in 8,000-year-old pottery shards from China, and the ancient Egyptians, that is 500 years ago, had a well-developed wine production system. So wine was the very well known to the human being. Then the fermentation to produce wine. The grape juice was the earlier raw material for the production of wine. So this is transferred to vats for the fermentation. This process is anaerobic and the temperature must be controlled because it generates the considerable heat. Then possible to ferment the grapes using the natural yeast that grows on them. This is the traditional method, but is often lead to the fermentation failures because other microorganisms will convert the sugar to sugar instead to alcohol. So here the contamination by the foreign bacteria may occur, and that will lead to the souring taste. So the addition of the fermentation should be very well monitored, and also it should be very well removed, as the most heat is generated in the wine production. Then the Louis Pasteur first studied the wine production from scientific point of view, and he recommended that sterilizing the grape juice, then introducing a pure culture of specific yeast. So to avoid this souring problem of this one, we have to first sterilize the raw material, and then we have to add the specific yeast that will lead to the alcohol production. Then sterilization is done by introducing the sulfur dioxide that will kill the bacteria. And different wineries each have their own special yeast. Yeast is different strain of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, also used in production of beer and bread. Then the fermentation will continue until all the sugar has been converted to alcohol, or until the alcohol concentration reaches about 18%. So this takes around 2 to 3 weeks. However, for sweet wine, the process is stopped before the sugar is used up by adding alcohol to the mixture by killing the yeast with sulfur dioxide gas. So here, either we can allow it to ferment fully, or we can stop before the sugar is converted. So that will lead to the sweet taste of the sugar, and the yeast is killed by this passing sulfur dioxide. And the secondary fermentation then takes place, testing several months. During this time, fine particles settle out the wine. This process is done under anaerobic condition. A lot of flavor develop occurs during the aging process. So as we have seen, the more is the older is the wine, is more is the tasty. So this is the reason, because the particles that will settle down and that will slowly fermented during the process. So the more is the age of wine, more is the taste to it, and as the taste is good in this one, more is the price for the that wine. Then before wine is blended and bottled, a clarifying agent such as gelatin is added to precipitate out the any remaining particle. So this also reduces tannin content. Tannin adds bitterness to the wine. The particles are then removed by filtering. In some wine, especially red wines, continue to improve with further aging in the bottle. So generally nowadays the red wines are building up because of their the medicinal value. So red wine is good for the heart, as stated in the research papers. So it is the more industrially produce wine as far as the medicinal value is considered. Then the next product is distilled spirit. So the alcohol content of beer and wine is limited by the fact that an alcohol concentration of 18% or more kills the yeast that is produced it. They produce the stronger alcohol, distillation is needed. The principle is that ethanol boils at a temperature lower than the water. So the alcohol boils off, leaving the water behind. You just need to capture the alcohol vapors and condense it. The first 1% and or so what distills off has headache in inducing components in it and is generally discarded. And distillation was invented by the Arabs around 700 AD. So the word alcohol came from the Arabic alcohol, which refers to coal or a precipitation of the darken, a precipitation used to darken the ice. Alternatively, alcohol, which means the monster or spirit. This word origin is somewhat debatable. So the spirit, which came from the this one, as the vapors which are coming out and that were giving the dizziness to the human being, so that was termed as the monster. So the spirit word came from that one, but is still debatable. Alcohol concentration is measured in proof, where each proof is 1.5%. So 80 proof means 40% alcohol. Most distilled spirit are 80 to 100%, 100 proof. Alcohol can only be distilled to 95%. It is colorless and tasteless. The color and taste of distilled spirit come from other byproducts of fermentation and aging that remains after distillation. Now we'll see the butyl alcohol and the acetone manufacturing. So until World War I, it was produced by dry distillation of calcium acetate from pyrogenesis acid. As the demand increases for the smokeless powder, the wise men develop a process utilizing fermentation of starch containing grains to yield acetone and butyl alcohol. So the Clostridium acetobutylicum bacteria is used for the production of the acetone and the butyl alcohol. The fermentation yields 2 parts of butyl alcohol to 1 part of acetone. So earlier no demand seen for butyl alcohol, but later the acetone became byproduct, whereas butyl alcohol got more demand. So the earlier it was the acetone which was majorly used for the production of the smokeless powder, and butyl alcohol has no value previously. But nowadays butyl alcohol got the more value than the acetone. So the acetone, which was the major product earlier, now become the byproduct. So the part of 2 parts of butyl alcohol to 1 part of acetone. So the part of butyl alcohol try to increase and lower down the acetone part. So the new culture developed, which feed on molasses, giving 3 parts of butyl alcohol to 1 part of acetone. Synthetic processes overcame the fermentation being very cheap. Also, molasses and grain prices increased at later stage. And today acetone is produced by oxidation of cumene or hydrogenation of isopropyl alcohol. Then it is used as solvent and in manufacturing of plastic. So the riboflavin, so it is one of the nutrient that is needed, and also it is useful for the stabilization of the beta complex vitamins. So it was produced as byproduct of butyl alcohol and the acetone fermentation. The concentration was very low in it. So today several biological processes produce it at good quality over lower cost synthetic processes. Then vinegar and acetic acid. So these are the major components which we are using in the kitchen. So vinegar, which is nothing but 4% of acetic acid, and acetic acid also used in the labs for as a solvent and in many reactions. So the aerobic bacterial oxidation by genus Acetobacter of dilute acetic acid at 8% is another ancient procedure furnishing vinegar, a flavored acetic acid solution fermented from wine, cedar, malt or dilute alcohol. The pure dilute alcohol fermented, pure dilute acetic acid results. Then yield is around 80 to 90%. So ethanol by the oxidation give acetaldehyde, which on further oxidation give acetic acid. So the acetic acid the percentage will lead to the vinegar, or the more the concentration will lead to the more purer acetic acid. Then the reaction is exothermic, hence it is dissipated by trickling alcohol or recirculated with special cooling. If the cedar, malt or wine fermented, vinegar rarely exceeds 5% due to limited sugar content in the raw material. Then for direct alcohol, it is 12 to 40% at which acidity bacteria thrive. Then fruit which is used gives flavor to product. And the synthetic is produced by ethylene or treating methanol with carbon monoxide. In the citric acid, so one of the most versatile organic acid used an acetone in carbonated beverages, jams, jellies and other foodstuffs. In medicinal fields to produce citrates and effervescent salts, industrially as ion sequestering buffer and acetyl tributyl citrate, a vinyl resin plasticizer. It manufactures by fermentation of crude sugar or corn sugar by special strain of Aspergillus niger, followed by the classical research by Curie. Then reaction sugar, then in presence of water and oxygen, will give C6H10O7 or dextrose can give the citric acid. The fermentation changes sugar and dextrose in branch chain. The special strains of yeast, the Candida, then Guillermandi, and the Candida lipolytica have been developed to produce citric acid. Then the Candida lipolytica produces it from paraffin in a continuous process. Then the lactic acid. So lactic acid is commonly found in the curd. So the scientifically it is 2-hydroxypropionic acid. So lactic acid weakens the carbon, 4 different groups are attached. So it is the carbon which is present centrally, it is chiral one. So primary found in sour milk, fermented of milk sugar, that is lactose, by Streptococcus lactic. So raw material here is, will be the hexose sugar from molasses, corn or milk, synthetically by acetaldehyde and lactonitrile. Then earlier it was produced by milk or byproducts of whey. Then used for deliming leather in tanning. Then edible grade acid used as acid acetylene in foods and beverages. The other uses are solvent, then plastic and chemical manufacturing. Then the enzymes which are produced. So over 3000 enzymes have been extracted and purified, can be stored dry and cool for several months or years. They are immobilized on support to give strain, again pH and temperature. So here immobilization is a technique that will save the bacterial from the pH and temperature. So what happens, there are two techniques to grow the bacteria. So one is suspension and one other is immobilization. So suspension, in water bacteria will grow and they will feed on nutrient and they will be remain suspended in water, whereas immobilization means there will have the support to grow on them. So generally the screens or the material which gives support to the bacterial growth, and on that material bacteria will form the bacterial biofilm. So that will lead them for the stronger stronger bacteria which we can fight against the change in pH and the temperature. So nowadays the fermentation or other most technique, they will based upon the immobilization. Also the bioremediation which occurs, it is based on the immobilization. So the bacteria which are using, they will secrete enzymes. So the enzymes which are of not the use for the bacteria, so they will pass to the solution, and those solution, the enzymes we can separate out. So the enzymes which we will see, so here proteases that is secreted, so that will use in cheese making, then digestive acid, then meat tenderizing, then beer chill proofing, then cereal syrup manufacturing, leather manufacturing. Then other most important enzyme is carbohydrates. So it will lead for the starch hydrolysis, sucrose inversion, then fruit juice and vinegar clarification, then flavor control. So here nucleases and hydrolysis enzyme, so that will use in destruction of toxic and undesirable components in the food. The oxidases, it will lead for the oxidation prevention and the color control in food products. Also for the clinical diagnostics, it will be used. And there are other several enzymes which we can use in order to produce the more useful products. Then other components which are produced in this, so they will be monosodium glutamate. So strain used for the production of monosodium glutamate, so they are micrococcus, then glutamicus and Bravibacterium divaricatum. They are used in food flavor enhancement. Then L-lysine, which is given by the Micrococcus glutamicus, then Bravibacterium flavum, then the Corynebacterium acetoglutamicum and Microbacterium aminoc- beryllium. Then dihydroxyacetone, that is HOCS2CO2H, is made by action of sorbus bacterium fermentation of glycerin, used as a catalyst and emulsifying agent. Then the pharmaceutical products such as antibiotics, biologicals, vitamins and hormones then produces complex chemical which is difficult to synthesize synthetically. So major problem in the pharmaceutical is the production of the various antibiotics and the vitamins. So as they are high molecular weight, also the structure is very complex. So it becomes very difficult to synthesize them synthetically. But bacteria, with the help of their organic processes, they can easily synthesize them. So if you see the antibiotics, then the common example is penicillin. Then if you see the biologicals, then there are various enzymes. Then hormones which are needed, like the insulin hormones, maybe it's produced by the use of fermentation technique, bacterial processes. Then various vitamins which are produced in the bacterial, so by the vitamins which are produced inside the bacterial cells, we can break cells and we can take them out. So here the complex reaction becomes very easy, and there is a major role in the pharmaceutical industry. So references, we can refer Dryden and Shriv. And next time we will refer the rubber industry, how to manufacture rubber naturally and synthetically. That we will see in the coming modules.